Hi, this is Ryan O'Gwynn, and today I am here with award-winning filmmaker Robert Butler. We are recording from Bertrand, Michigan, and we have gathered here today for a special purpose. We are bringing you a retrospective and analysis of cinema in 2018. Now, those of you with remarkable taste and attention spans that have not been ruined by social media will recall that my last podcast was posted in June of this year. So it's only taken me 7 months to follow up, which, all things considered, isn't too bad. We're back on the saddle, and after a somewhat remarkable year of films, we are here to bring you the scoop. And look, if you haven't seen everything we're talking about, we're going to try to make it as accessible as possible. Now, I'm assuming that the majority of people who will listen to this podcast are vaguely familiar with who I am, at least. If not, you can go to my last one and I go into some autobiographical details in that. But Robert, would you like to talk about yourself for a moment?
You know, thank you, Ryan, for joining me today. You know, Ryan, you came up with a great idea. How about we just have a podcast and just talk about 2018 in general, about cinema and how we felt about it, and name some of our favorite films that made an impression on us. And we'll talk about other movies that the film critics love that we probably didn't quite as connect with. And we'll discuss that today. And if anybody does not know me, yes, I'm Robert Joseph Butler. I've done numerous award-winning short films. I have a new feature film in post-production right now titled Love Immoral. It stars Richard Tyson. You know, Richard Tyson, the iconic actor from Kindergarten Cop, the villain. He also appears in Black Hawk Down and There's Something About Mary. So keep an outlook for Love Immoral. I hope to get that film done and put out in the festival circuit this year, in all hopes that it gets some type of distribution somewhere or another. It's the end game as any filmmaker. And I also write for defactofilmreviews.com. That's, again, Defacto Film Reviews. I'm the chief film critic on that site. We have a couple other film writers on the site as well, and Noah Domrin and also Ben Rothrock have been helping me out with the reviews, because it's just very challenging to review and see everything these days. There's so much content out there, Ryan, so many movies, and it's very challenging to see everything. We did our damn best, wouldn't you say, seeing everything this year.
I think we have done due diligence, certainly. We have been, we call ourselves soldiers of cinema. We pursue this with abandon. You know, we love films. We have done a lot to see everything that we can in 2018. And you know, when you live in the Midwest, in a state like Michigan, this often involves driving long distances, and in my opinion, it's always worth it. It has been a particularly strong year for films overall, I would say. I really like 2013. I thought 2016 was good, but it's been kind of backloaded, however. It seems like much of the really good stuff has come out right here at the end of the year, but that's okay. It's better than nothing coming out at all. So without further ado, we will explore some of these titles and hope you enjoy. Now, it's worth mentioning that in the process of getting ready to do this podcast today, we have faced many technical difficulties, but it would not be my podcast if there weren't technical difficulties. I really could stand to hire a crew, I think. I'm not a big tech guy, but anyway, we're making do. And so, look, I think if you want to listen to this, you're going to listen to it with an echo or without. So this is the state that the podcast is in currently. We burned through about two or three other options that simply weren't coming together for us. So we are recording this in a downstairs office, and that is why it perhaps sounds slightly less professional than your typical radio broadcast, but that's okay. Our content is much better, so savor it. Anyway, Rob, I'll give it back over to you and introduce our next title on the list here.
Yeah, you know, overall 2018, I don't want to make this a thing where we're tearing movies down, but I want to start off by just talking about the movies that the film critics really loved. We just went through Black Klansman. I think the next one I'd like to touch on is First Reformed. Now, look, this is a film that is greatly acted by Ethan Hawke. Ethan Hawke delivers a very raw performance that's just absolutely filled with a lot of heartbreak. He's an isolated individual. You know, the film is written and directed by Paul Schrader, of course, you know, the writer of Taxi Driver and Raging Bull and other Scorsese films like The Last Temptation of Christ and Bringing Out the Dead. And a lot of people know him just as that. They don't know that he's this indie filmmaker as well. And he's done such acclaimed films as The Brilliant Autofocus, which is about Bob Crane, biography about him and his sex addiction, played wonderfully by Greg Kinnear, that came out in 2002. He also did a film like Mishima, A Life in Four Chapters, and he's directed a lot of films, American Gigolo, Hardcore, and now film critics are just coming out. I almost forgot that he did make movies, because I really liked Autofocus, and I just never really heard from him again, because a lot of his movies after that got very limited releases, or they tanked really bad, just never got to see him. And Ryan, I know you're a big fan of Paul Schrader, and man, these critics are just loving this film. Overall, I would give the film a positive review. I think that I mainly for the performances, and there's some really good writing scenes in the film. There's some really good dialogue passages, some really good exchanges, and there are some, you know, ideas in the movie that we need to face about the environment. The environment is constantly changing, and you know, pollution's definitely a bad thing, and but at the same time, though, this is a movie about a preacher, and the movie does get really preachy at times. I think Schrader at times goes a little too overboard with him being so didactic. What did you feel about this movie?
Yes, I think it's also worth mentioning Schrader, Michigan native, born and raised in Grand Rapids, Michigan, and I am a big fan of much of his work anyway, and it's fitting that we bring this up now, because initially my first podcast that I did back in June, I had done it immediately in the wake of seeing the films Hereditary and then First Reform, and I had intended to do a deep dive into Paul Schrader's career, because though I was also not blown away by First Reformed, it did inspire me to go back and revisit a lot of his work. And he has had a remarkable career. He's a complex guy, not always a likable guy, not always ideologically sound, in my opinion, but an extremely underrated filmmaker. I mean, stuff like Hardcore, the films you mentioned, Affliction, Autofocus, Mishima, American Gigolo, Dog Eat Dog from 2016. He has done so much varied and interesting work. It's amazing to me that he's not brought up more often, but it seems to be he's finally having his day with this First Reformed movie. And I, as Rob said, the performance by Ethan Hawke is strong, but I wasn't blown away by it. I mean, it's got a lot of ingredients that are going to get a positive critical evaluation. You know, it's like critical of religion, and it's the premise of the film is that a pastor undergoes a crisis of faith after a young man turns him on to the idea of global warming. And I found that a little tough to swallow, to be honest with you, but it's something else. I mean, it's very austere. He's modeling himself on like certain European directors like Bresson, the French director, and Ingmar Bergman. It's like everything's framed perfectly, and like it's very square. The aspect ratio is 1:3:3, and it's like it is a very cold, didactic film, but it is well made. But there are many problems. It's not one of my favorites of the year, and I think the critical evaluation of it was wildly exaggerated.
Oh, I agree. It's definitely wildly exaggerated. But, you know, that being said, I like the visual style of this movie. There's just a lot of static, beautifully composed shots in this movie. Because let's face it, Paul Schrader's been accused before of having, like, a TV directing style. Some people accused him of that. You know, you look at it like a film like Affliction, which is a brilliant film, but we don't walk away admiring the visuals in that film. We're walking away admiring the themes and we're admiring the performances by Nick Nolte and James Coburn, and the writing is just so beautiful in Affliction. It's a very devastating work. While First Reformed, I feel he's elevated his visual style in this movie perhaps more than others. I actually saw a good visual style in Doggy Dog, though, too, Ryan, and I think he's starting to become more comfortable behind the camera, because you can look at those other films and be like, well, this is more of a writer at work. Even autofocus, while creates a good mood and atmosphere, at times it doesn't have that Scorsese energy that you'd expect it to. But, you know, that being said, though, Affliction's still a stronger movie because it's got a stronger script. And let's face it, First Reformed goes with the typical Schrader themes of alienation and self-destruction. Almost every one of his films, dating back to his earlier scripts like Taxi Driver, what he's best known for, and now to the movies he directs, all of his characters, main characters, are mostly male protagonists who go on a very dark journey of self-destruction and agony.
That is the Schrader template, indeed. Like I was telling you the other day, he's probably the director who's gotten the most mileage out of using essentially the same story over and over again, but adjusting enough variables to make it interesting and compelling each time.
Oh, for sure.
Nicolas Cage is always a welcome addition to any film, in my opinion. Yeah. He is truly an absurdist icon. But want to talk about Mandy?
Sure, we could talk, yeah, Mandy.
On the subject of Cage, so seems fitting. I mean, the culmination of a bizarre career, in my opinion. We saw Mandy at the historic Howell Theater, which I'm a big fan of. In fact, that screening back in September, it was mid-September that we saw Mandy. It was a one-night event at the Howell Theater, and it was my first time ever being there, and it was just a terrific experience. But the movie, it definitely one of the most bold, uncompromising visions of the year. It is absolutely a genre film, but done in an experimental style, and it's a straight revenge story, but told with surrealist, expressionistic elements. It's every single shot in the film is clearly labored over. The director is Panos Cosmatos. His dad directed Tombstone, and what were the other 80s action movies?
Cobra. He directed Cobra.
Yes.
The Rambo, First Blood.
Okay.
Yeah.
First Blood 2.
First Blood 2, yes.
Anyway, that's sort of his background, you know. He grew up around that, and there definitely is many traces of 80s action in Mandy, and the whole thing is just totally wild, and it's a polarizing film. It seems like people either seem to really enjoy it or be totally put off by it. I was impressed. I got a lot out of it, and it was a highlight of the year, absolutely.
You know, Mandy is just a very, like you said, it's a very bizarre movie. It's a movie that takes the kind of like this mood and atmosphere of surrealism and merges it with like 80s machismo action movies, and it just completely works. As crazy as that sounds, it just combines these two genres. And yeah, Nicolas Cage, a lot of people like to make fun of him, and he's become almost like a self-parody, especially online. And when you go to Lollapalooza, and then people be having t-shirts of him and stuff like that. It's like people are mocking him and whatnot. But if you look at Nicolas Cage's career, it's really great. I mean, he got a performance like this that, you know, it's got some great dramatic moments. It's got the crazy action in the film. It's got the crazy Nicolas Cage performance that you'd like to see. But at the same time, it's got some really strong dramatic moments that Nicolas Cage has. And the acting chops in the movie allow you to look back and say, wow, this performance is very comparable to something like Spike Jonze's adaptation, or, you know, like Mike Figgis's Leaving Las Vegas, which I find to be some of his best work and his best performances. But it's really strong performance. And yes, the style in the film was just very, quite visually arresting. You know, I didn't love the movie. I liked it quite a bit, though. I will say that it grew in my mind after I saw it, and it just got a lot of great noir moments. It's like watching a Hell on Earth noir movie.
Yeah.
You know?
Bret Easton Ellis said about Mandy, he's like, imagine David Lynch directing Friday the 13th. He's like, that's either going to sound awesome to you or, like, terrible. But I think also Linus Roach as the cult leader, Jeremiah Sand, one of my favorite supporting performances of the year. I mean, it's just a fearless performance, and the dude's primarily known from Law and Order.
Yeah,
you know,
it's a great villain indeed, and the ending, not to spoil anything, but the ending, the confrontation between the two, it just feels like it's right out of a Nicholas Refn film.
Yeah,
you know, he's the director of Drive, and you know, Only God Forgives, and Neon Demon. It just has this Dario Argento, you know, neon type light aesthetic that works very well in creating this hellish atmosphere. Everything from the brooding score with the synthesizers to create the mood is just very effective. And yeah, this is a movie I actually like to revisit again.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're talking about, now let's talk about our favorite films of the year. We could sit and talk about a lot of films we found to be a little overrated that we still appreciate it, but now let's talk about the movies we absolutely love. Ryan, I know you absolutely love Mandy. I'm sure that would make your top 10 list at the end of the year. So let's talk about some of our films that made a strong impression on us, ones that we just absolutely love. Now, I'm not going to make an official top 10 list on here because I still have two movies left to see. I need to see Cold War, and I need to see the Japanese film Shoplifters that won the top prize at the Palme d'Or. So once I see those two films, I'll certainly secure a top 10 on my website, defactofilmreviews.com. Now, the movie I wanted to talk about next, Ryan, is Eighth Grade. I think we get a lot of films these days about teenagers. We get a lot of films about adolescents. You can almost say this is a very oversaturated genre. You have films like Lady Bird that just recently came out, Diary of a Teenage Girl, The Edge of 17. This year you had Love, Simon. You have Perks of Being a Wallflower. You could go on and on about this genre. This has been going on for the longest time now, dating back to, you know, like Ferris Bueller's Days Off and John Hughes films. The teenage movies are something that we cherish as film viewers, you know. Now, I think Eighth Grade is actually one of the stronger ones lately that we've got. I thought there was a lot of great authenticity in the movie. It's written and directed by Bo Burnham, who, as we know, is a very famous guy on YouTube. He's got his own YouTube channel that just pulls in millions of viewers. He's a comedian as well.
Sound like a comedian slash performance artist, post-ironic type dude.
Right, and here he comes out with a film this year that made a huge splash at the Sundance Film Festival. I think the film's like 100% on Rotten Tomatoes, or 99% at least. Everybody just loves this film, rightfully so, too. It's, you know, the film stars a young girl named Elise Fischler, who also is a YouTube star, I guess. She's got her own YouTube channel. I thought it was great to cast her because she brought this authenticity that I don't think a normal Hollywood actress would have brought. And what you get with that performance is her alienation, or her rather awkwardness, that just rings so true. So I feel like this is one of the more honest and real films of the year. It's about a young teenage girl in eighth grade getting ready to make that big transition into high school. And she doesn't have many friends. She doesn't have a boyfriend. She doesn't really open up to anybody. And she's very socially awkward, but she's allowed to be herself on social media. So it actually has a lot of commentary on how teenagers live now in the age of technology and the digital world and such. So I think this is a very authentic movie with a lot of, rendered with just a lot of human pathos and a lot of great characterizations in this movie.
A lot of pathos indeed. I did find the character, the protagonist, the female protagonist, I thought she was very sympathetic. I liked the movie a lot. I didn't love it. I did like it a lot. Like you said, I think it is like a John Hughes filtered through a modern lens. You know, put a John Hughes film in a time travel machine to 2018. And I mean, it's not nearly as light as those films. You know, there is a palpable darkness in Eighth Grade, which is realist. You know, it is realist. That was my experience being a teenager and whatnot. I can imagine it's only 10 times worse now, but I thought it was very charming and endearing.
Oh, definitely. A very charming movie indeed. But like you said, it does have moments in the film that have some dark complexities. You know, Elise Fisher in the movie, she starts to have boys come on to her. And there's a really disturbing scene in the movie where her character, Kayla Day, she goes out with older kids because the high school girl that she meets is her chaperone in high school, kind of walking around and show what high school is, to show these middle schoolers that high school is not this terrifying thing. And so she kind of is her liaison for the day, and she ends up liking Kayla a lot. And they go out to the mall with their older friends, And then one of her friends ends up taking her back home, and then he ends up kind of coming onto her in the back seat. He has her go there, and she's a virgin, and there's a lot of innocence, and he's trying to rob her innocence away, but she's allowed to reject that. But it's a very uncomfortable scene, and rather much needed. And I know that A24, the distributor, actually gave free tickets away to 8th graders in the film. I know there was some controversy saying that 8th graders shouldn't see this movie. I do think 8th graders should see this movie.
Yeah.
There's a lot of stuff in that movie that does ring true in that film, and they need to be aware of some of these things that they face.
I don't think anything in that film is as bad as what they're seeing on social media every night.
No, that's true, yeah. But I would definitely say 8th grade is one of the highlights of the year. It's one of my favorite films of the year. You know, it's right now, it's sitting number 10 on my list right now, so it could very well make the top 10, depending on how well I love Shoplifters or how I love Cold War, which I'm very excited for. But yeah, Elise Fisher definitely delivers one of the best performances of the year, I feel, in the best actors category. And the actor, Josh Hamilton, who plays her father in the film, Mark Day, who's just,
yeah.
Oh gosh, that scene that towards the end when they're sitting in the campfire, and just kind of reassures her. Throughout the film, he's trying to reach out to her the best he can. He doesn't know how to do it.
I found that kind of, I will say, in regard to the father-daughter relationship, I found it kind of off-putting at first. I mean, she was like borderline abusive towards her dad, but it does have a tremendous emotional payoff. You know, it's building up to something. But at first I was like, geez, you know, but...
Yeah, he's basically like, hey, I've dealt with this before.
He's a single dad.
He's trying to see how his daughter is doing. He's a great father. He's really reassuring. He's supportive. He's caring about what his daughter's doing. And like you said in the movie, she has nothing... She's just very cold to him. She holds almost the disdain towards him. She's always on her phone. She doesn't want to talk about it. She just wants to be plugged in, almost like how modern kids are these days.
Oh, yeah.
And it captures that quite well. But when she starts to open up and realize that he definitely cares about her, and when they have that monologue at the end when he opens up to her and tells her how much she means to him, that was just a great payoff in the film. And you know, for me, it was almost like a teenage version of an Alexander Payne movie.
Yeah.
You have a deeply flawed character that's built up with great payoffs, with great characterizations. Overall, it's a really fantastic character study about our modern world.
Speaking of fairly new directors, Bo Burnham, I believe 8th grade was his debut. In fact, I'm certain it was his debut film. We have one of the year-end surprises, in my opinion, total dark horse, was Vox Lux, directed by Brady Corbett, who I am infuriated to admit is the same age as myself, 30 years old. That is devastating. But the film is sort of like the anti-Star is Born. It's a total Faustian bargain, downfall, pop star nightmare. And I saw the trailer for it when we were at the State Theater in Ann Arbor. I thought it looked compelling. I think Natalie Portman is a very talented actress. And, you know, when I saw that trailer, I said, I am going to see this. I did not expect it to be as good as it is. It is a scathing satire on the current state of popular culture and overall just a very cohesive, very solid and complete work of art. Rob, how about you comment on Vox Lux?
You know, we have nobody really to thank for this movie right now other than, well, the trailer looked impressive, but I wanted to thank my fellow de facto film reviewer, Noah Domran, who went and saw this movie, and he's like, Rob, you have to go see this movie. I mean, and he said that he knows I love Southland Tales. I'm in the minority. I absolutely love Southland Tales, even though it does have a little cult following of people. But
yeah.
He said this is like the most, this is exact words, this is the most bizarre movie I've seen since Southland Tales, in terms of just the way it ends and some of the themes. And he said it was very similar. And I was like, wow. I told you that, Ryan. And I think that just made us get to the theater. Because let's face it, they came out in a very busy week.
Yes.
Leading up to Christmas. We had so many movies just coming out at the end of the year. We have Roma. We had Burning. Gosh, you have Bill Street Could Talk. All this stuff just being flooded in December. It's like the worst time. Neon distributed the movie. Sadly, it's not doing well, and I wish it did. But
yeah.
If it wasn't for him comparing it to Southland Tales, I don't know if I would have got to see it. And you're absolutely right. It's a visionary work of art. I absolutely love this film. It is the big surprise of the year. I did not anticipate this movie. I first read about it. It was about Natalie Portman playing a pop star. I didn't know it was going to be like this. But the film is just very surreal. It's very much in the vein of like a Don DeMillo novel.
Yes.
It really is. If you're familiar with Don DeMillo, you know, David Cronenberg adapted his Cosmopolis film.
White Noise. Underworld.
The thing of it is that the movie actually had a Cronenberg film to it. And,
yeah.
And you know, the writer and director of the film, Brady Corbett, he's spent a lot of his acting career working with brilliant directors.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like Lars von Trier, Michael Haneke. You know, he's worked with Olivia Assayas. And there's some Assayas elements in this film, too. But at the same time, it didn't feel derivative of these directors. It felt like there was still this fresh voice coming through. And I really can't wait to see what he does next. And as for Natalie Portman, I would say this is her greatest performance that I've seen of her since Black Swan. I would put that up there as one of her finest performances.
Yes.
I think she's the greatest actress of our generation.
She's fantastic.
Yeah.
And it's a dark trip, but it's a trip worth taking. You know, I think a lot of people saw the trailer and perhaps thought maybe it was like a retread of Black Swan. And honestly, though there are parallel themes, I don't think the two films could be more different. Would make a cool double feature, but they're, in essence, very different, in my opinion. And I think Vox Lux is almost dreamlike at times. It's dreamlike, but nevertheless socially relevant. In fact, it's a hard film to talk about because there are facets of it that it's essential that they be a surprise, in my opinion. You know, that was part of the impact for me watching it. But yeah, it was like we were driving all over the place trying to see that thing at the last minute before it got dropped after it had been playing for like a week or two.
Yeah, you know, it's almost like a hidden treasure that you had to find. And I'm very happy I saw it in the theater. But that being said, you know, comparing it to Southland Tales, I think it's a very fair comparison because both films deal with terrorism at many levels. And, you know, Southland Tales came out during the Iraq War, after 9/11 America, and the film is brilliant. It's really like a satire and an absurdist study of post 9/11 America in a post 9/11 world. And then this film comes out and it's very much dealing with the same themes, except for it's almost like about a pop star in the film. And you know, it's played by Rafferty Cassidy. She starts off playing the young Celeste in the movie, and she also plays Albertine, who is Natalie Portman's daughter later in the movie. So she plays two roles, which I thought to be very fascinating. Rafferty Cassidy is the young actress that was in Yorgos Lanthimos, The Killing of a Sacred Deer. I think this young actress has a lot of great potential, indeed.
Yeah.
But, yeah, you know, the film starts off and she's a victim to the school shooting, kind of showing that she's kind of like born into this school shooting, post-Columbine kind of world. And she's like the star that rises out of the tragedy. And she has a wound. She's wounded from it. She gets shot in the neck and she's covered up in that. And then the film has three chapters, really. It's got the first two chapters and it has a finale narrated by Willem Dafoe. But the film, it just takes you on an unexpected direction. And the performance by Natalie Portman, I feel, is a standout. It's a great performance, a lot of great dialogue. And Jude Law, who plays the manager, nameless.
Yes.
A great performance by Jude Law here is getting completely overlooked this year by the critics. But this film just really stays with you. It's a very haunting work of art, and after I saw it, it just lingered in my mind like Southland Tales, and it's a film that I could certainly see myself revisit time after time, year after year, just like Southland Tales did.
It was an absolute treat, and I remember sitting there at the MGR in Troy, you know, about halfway through the movie, I was just sitting there thinking, this is why I go so often. You know, it's experiences like this, and we've had quite a few of those experiences in 2018. We've been quite blessed, but I was just, you know, like, this is pure cinema, is excellent, you know. And I think it's interesting how this year there seems to be a lot of reflection on the national trauma of 9/11. It's palpable. It is in the air. One of the best novels of this year, and I'll touch on this very briefly because this is not a literature podcast. One of the best novels of the year, My Year of Rest and Relaxation by Atessa Mashfeh. And that's about a young woman in her 20s who continually doses herself with psychiatric medication to sleep for an entire year. And after the year, there's spoiler alert if anybody wants to pause or skip the next 30 seconds. at the very end of it, the Twin Towers are attacked. You know, it's 9/11. And then also Vice with Christian Bale, the Dick Cheney biopic. We don't have to go into that in detail right now, but nevertheless, it's just like it is in the air. Like this sort of, I guess it is reflection, reflecting on where we've come since. I mean, 9/11 happened at the very beginning of the millennium. We're about to enter into the Roaring 20s 2.0, you know, and I think there is some soul-searching, some collective soul-searching, especially in this divided political climate. But I'll turn it over to you.
Yeah, Vox Lux, just a fascinating work of art. You know, I wish that this movie got some more celebrating than it did. Just it's a movie that a lot of film critics are celebrating, and Natalie Portman not even getting any buzz to this film is very, very odd to me, because I think it's right up there with some of the finest performances of the year, like Lady Gaga, Star is Born, Melissa McCarthy, Can You Ever Forgive Me? You know, the actress from Roma, it's just right up there. And, you know, it just is a movie that lurks under your skin right when you open. Right when the film opens, it just has this unease about it, like a Cronenberg movie, where something feels very off-kilter. It feels like something's lurking beneath the surface, and it reveals itself in a very shocking and explicit way, and it takes you on a great journey. And it really, at the end of the day, it's really a strong film, and it's making a really profound statement, I feel, about stardom and about vanity. And really, at the end of the day, you could have all that stuff, but and it's really truly in the end. And it's really empty in the end is really the point of the movie.
And that kind of thing is, I don't know if I would call it scary, but to me the most unsettling type of films are like you're describing, where there's just a sense that something is off, where it's like a weird dream or something. Like, of course, David Lynch is the touchstone for that kind of thing, but I find that kind of stuff ultimately more unsettling and therefore more exciting to experience than like monsters jumping out of the closet or something like that. I prefer that creepy sense of off-kilter unreality.
Oh, yeah, that first 10 minutes when it gets involved in that school shooting, wow.
Yeah.
It's just so unnerving. But, definitely I think this film has a strong chance of cracking my top 10 list for sure.
So, while my stamina is still at a manageable level, I suppose I'll get into one of my favorite films of the year, and that is The House That Jack Built, the new film by Lars von Trier. Now, to even begin to approach this film, it's necessary to have a solid background in the director's career. Lars von Trier, he's a rare filmmaker who I think his persona, his whole biography, his whole body of work is inseparable from everything that he does. And this really needs to be understood before seeing anything by him, because otherwise I think some of his work could be highly off-putting, and some people do hate the man, or at least his work. You know, it's an extremely polarizing figure in the world of art house film. But Lars is a filmmaker from Denmark. He has been active since the late 80s, mid to late 80s, I would say. And his signature is deliberate provocation. The films are deliberately provocative and smash taboos and are often highly transgressive, but not in an infantile way. I think that the stuff he does is very intelligent and thoughtful, and I may be in the minority with that opinion, but I do think this stuff is worth watching. Now, The House That Jack Built was one of the most controversial films to play at the Cannes Film Festival this year. The reason is that it centers around a serial killer played by Matt Dillon. And I'll be the first to say I am usually not an advocate for serial killer films. I think that fascination is often deeply perverse and ghoulish. However, I do trust Lars von Trier, and so I was at this film opening night. To the extent that there was an opening night, it was a one-night screening in which one could see the director's cut without anything censored from it. The controversy lies in the fact that there are depictions of violence against women, children are killed in it, and you're probably thinking, why would you watch something like that? This sounds awful. And I hear you, but it's more nuanced than one would expect from the synopsis. I mean, actually, when you sit down and watch the film, the actual violence, the actual content that one might find objectionable is not as harsh as you would expect. I mean, compared to the type of nonsense that we see these days, even on cable television. I mean, here at this podcast, we do not promote exploitation films or torture porn or any of that garbage. And this is much different. This is, I mean, really, this is a very scholarly, academic, artfully done piece of work. Before the film, there were brief video transmissions from both Matt Dillon and the director Lars von Trier. And it's notable that Lars emphasized that one must stay until the end of the film, at least in order to appreciate it to the fullest. And that is absolutely true. Like, there are elements in the beginning of it that might seem exploitative initially, but I do think that the what's called the epilogue in this film is essential to tying the whole thing together. And I don't want to spoil too much, but I had heard this before I went to see it, that believe me, it all comes together in the end, and that's very much true in this case. Turn it over to you, Rob.
This is a movie that I actually had very little expectations for, only because at the Cannes Film Festival, we heard about the stuff that you mentioned. We heard about children being killed. We heard about animal cruelty. You know, we heard about most of his victims being women, and it was almost like Lars von Trier was pulling a stunt on his detractors. And von Trier has that personality. So I walked in that movie with very little expectations, wasn't getting panned, and I walked out blown away by the movie. And you do have to stick with it. It's really a fascinating journey. And, you know, of course you're going to have sick audiences, demented people going to see that movie just because it is about a serial killer. But at the same time, though, there is nuance to it, like you said there is. It's very much von Trier almost deconstructing his own work. It's almost like von Trier taking a page or two from Jean-Luc Godard and playing with narrative as a whole, playing with the point of art. But at the end of the day, this film is redemptive. With all the vileness that's at hand, there's something about the human condition found in this movie. There's something humane about this movie, believe it or not. And even like the strongest scene in the film, the film is separated in pretty much five chapters with an epilogue. And the epilogue, let me tell you, is the greatest finale of any finale, pretty much, of any movie I've seen. You know, pretty much up there with Burning, which we'll talk about later, and Roma. You know, the House that Jack Built is certainly one of my favorite films of the year, but that epilogue is absolutely provocative and breathtaking, and not to reveal anything, it's very disturbing. And it gives you this unnerving feeling, but there's a scene in the film that are called incidences. You know, he's a serial killer. He claims, Jack has claimed in the film that he's murdered over 60 people while he narrates the movie. And there's a scene in the fourth incident where he's with a girlfriend, and he refers to her as Simple, played by Hollywood actress Hailey Q, who's actually in a lot of independent movies, believe it or not. She actually likes to work with great directors, but that scene was a very disturbing moment. You feel a lot of great empathy there for Simple. She's a very vulnerable woman. She's very insecure, and you see Jack just completely exploiting that, and he's manipulating her because he is very sophisticated, and he knows how to get inside her mind and kind of reel her in and all that. You feel really bad for her, and you know that she's going to die, and there's a helplessness to the scene that feels very suffocating. And von Trier brings a lot of great empathy to that character, where you can't just dismiss this as typical exploitation, because there's a lot of humanity found in that particular moment. Other moments that are separate in the movie, Ryan, I think you could agree that that would be like the most humane chapter in the movie. There's another chapter that's very playful, where von Trier is being very playful to the audience, where Jack goes into a house and he has OCD, and then the camera just like cuts in this very bizarre sounds, and he has to keep going back in the house to clean up the blood, because in his mind, the blood and the mess is just killing him. And then a cop comes by, and he has to get rid of the body so the cop doesn't notice. It's actually very hilarious. There's dark humor in that, and I found myself laughing very hard. And there's other moments that are very philosophical in the film too. And there's a lot of references in the movie to a lot of great art and great history, montages over the imagery and whatnot that gives it like this academic Godardian essay on many layers of life and philosophy.
Indeed. When I heard that Gaspar Noé laughed throughout the whole screening at the Cannes Film Festival, I assumed that he was just being provocative or trolling or what have you. But it is genuinely one of the funniest movies of the year. It's a very European sense of humor, very dry and deadpan. But nevertheless, there are moments that are quite funny. And I'm not a big comedy guy in film, but it's just almost absurd at certain times. But nevertheless, it's not light material. And it's worth mentioning that there's a lot of self-mythologizing going on in the house that Jack built. It's almost like a retrospective of his whole career. Like I was saying to Rob and our friend Jake after the movie, I hope this isn't like foreshadowing his retirement or something like that. But in a way, the incidents in the film, which are murders, of course, it's almost like a commentary on his own work. Because if you're not familiar with von Trier, he's very well known for casting actresses in the lead roles of his film and within narratives that depict women in peril. And he's known to be a very demanding director, and there's been friction on certain sets and whatnot. So it's like the whole film is almost like a metaphor for his career and body of work. And the coda, which I won't, or the epilogue rather in this case, which I won't reveal, but it is almost like his indictment of himself. And it's very compelling, very deeply fascinating in my opinion. It's like you can't imagine anyone else doing something like this. It is really one of a kind, you know. It is indeed narcissistic in a way. It is overblown. There's some grandstanding going on, but it absolutely works somehow. And it's inspiring to me to watch something like that. It's like you can do anything, you know, with confidence. And I do think he's a director with tremendous confidence, earned confidence.
And I wanted to say that I do think this is actually one of von Trier's finest films. And my favorite film of his, of course, would probably be Breaking the Waves and Dogville and Dance in the Dark and Melancholia, but I would say this is up there within his top five, and I feel that this movie is just a masterpiece of von Trier's body of work, one of his stronger films. A very mesmerizing movie, too. A film that has just haunted me ever since I've seen it. It almost does play off like a Henry Portrait of a Serial Killer in a way, the iconic serial killer movie from the late 80s that spent like 3 years playing in and out of theaters, and then finally got distributed on VHS in the early 90s and built into a cult following because it really studies a serial killer and kind of gets inside of his mind. And let's talk about Matt Dillon's performance here. This is a year with a lot of strong actors this year playing strong male leads. And often we're talking about strong female characters, and year after year we're praising films with women playing vulnerable roles. And this is a year almost of like the vulnerable male role, if you will. And not to say that Matt Dillon's character is vulnerable, as he's not. He's a monster. But I would say, like, out of all the performances we've seen this year, this one, he is probably embodied the most. His methods in this film are just very effective. The performance feels very chilling. And when you see it, you don't think of Matt Dillon. You think of Jack. Just, like, you just pause the movie. You look into those eyes. It's not Matt Dillon. You see Jack, the maniacal serial killer in the film. And just everything from his mannerisms to his physique and posture and his observations are just so unique and breathtaking. You could tell that together between von Trier and Matt Dillon, that they work really well together, and that he really honed in a masterful performance that needs to get more attention than what it currently is.
It's a totally unhinged performance in the best way. And there is also a very fascinating progression from beginning to end. Like, you notice in the first incident, he's very tentative and reserved and timid and whatnot. By the time we get to the fourth incident with Riley Keough, he's much more virile. You know, he's got the stubble and looks cool as opposed to looking like a nerd in the beginning of the movie. He's much more confident. And really, the confidence in his case is complete and utter arrogance as he talks down to and abuses that woman. But it's nevertheless a very layered character study.
Definitely a great pick. Certainly one of the finer films of the year. Certainly a film that I think will stand the test of time and will find a greater audience in years to come. One film I want to add that I just walked out completely crushed and just heartbroken about, a film that made a very strong impression on me this year, was Julian Schnabel's latest feature, At Eternity's Gate, which stars Willem Dafoe as Vincent van Gogh. And this is not your traditional biopic-type movie. It's a film that explores almost the last years of Vincent van Gogh. And anybody who knows the story knows quite well that van Gogh never got true recognition. He fits that artist cliche. Like he's not celebrated till he dies. And Schnabel plays off of that. He captures the last years of his life. And it kind of shows how he couldn't sell a painting. Now everybody just hold a lot of disgust and disdain towards his art. And just it just really captured a man's soul completely destroyed by his outer surroundings. You have this mind and his psychology was completely fragmented, and I'm sure that's what led to his depression, because this was his passion. His passion was painting, and he couldn't get any appreciation of that. And then for this film, Schnabel, who's an artist himself, a very renowned painter and artist out in New York, now a filmmaker who's made such films as Before Night Falls and the masterpiece The Diving Bell and the Butterfly. His first feature was about Basquiat. So Schnabel's interest lies in making films about other artists. That's what he does. And this is now his fifth feature film. And this is one of his finest. This film has the aesthetics of almost like a Terrence Malick type movie. And the vibrant colors in this film are absolutely striking. And let me tell you, Willem Dafoe's performance here is absolutely authentically real and just overall shattering. There's a lot of great empathy that Dafoe brought into this performance in this movie. You feel his heartbreak, his anxieties. It's a very vulnerable performance. You cannot help not to be deeply moved by the performances in this film, especially by Willem Dafoe and just the whole observations and exploration of him and his brother. And his brother was like the only one really that really supported him throughout his life, who was always there for him. And it's just a very touching movie. And I think that this ranks up there with like Inside Llewyn Davis by the Coen brothers, or even Robert Altman's own Vincent and Theo, where the filmmakers are really standing up for the artist, standing up and showing that art's really a great form of suffering. And he really celebrates that quite well. And Schnabel's, like I said, his aesthetics in the film are very experimental in a way. The tight close-ups and the way he uses sound and landscapes is just truly impeccable.
Indeed. I had my reservations about the film. I remember when we were initially discussing it, this was a couple of months before it actually got a release, I believe, and I heard the premise of it and that it was Willem Dafoe playing Van Gogh and that Julian Schnabel was going to direct. I remember saying, it's either going to be brilliant or a disaster. And Van Gogh meant a lot to me, especially like as a teenager. I am a champion of the fine arts. I have no talent in the fine arts, but I do admire painters and sculptors and that type of thing. And I had my doubts as to whether a film could do justice to Vincent Van Gogh. I'd read his collected letters over a decade ago, and those were very compelling. I have never seen Vincent and Theo, the Robert Altman film. I may check that out in the coming year, but At Eternity's Gate, it really is a dark horse this year because it didn't do incredibly well at the box office. I remember the morning we arrived at the Maple to see it, I posted jokingly that I was thrilled to be among so many enthusiastic art lovers because we were in an empty theater and few people ended up showing up, but it is one of the underrated films of the year. It really made an impression on me, and it is very moving and resonant. There's that great line where he says, maybe I'm a painter for people who aren't born yet. And I recommend anyone listening to this that hasn't seen it, just watch the trailer. The trailer is fantastic in itself, but I felt very positively about the movie.
You know, another character that I absolutely love in the film is Oscar Isaac, who plays, you know, the painter, Paul Gauguin. And it kind of explores that Gauguin was also a champion of Van Gogh's work. He saw his work, and every time those two are on screen together, Defoe playing Van Gogh and, you know, Oscar Isaac playing Gauguin, was just absolutely moving and tender. And there's a lot of back and forth between the two, where you see the two, you see the jealousy, you see a competition between the two, but there's still a respect and admiration the two also have for each other. And there's this one moment in the movie that just pained me when Gauguin finally sells his art as well, and he starts to get celebrated. His paintings are taken off, and Chernobyl leaves it very ambiguous. Is he crushed? Is Van Gogh crushed because he's successful as a painter? Is he crushed because he's leaving his life right there? Because it was Gauguin who told him to get out of the bleakness, to get out of the cloudy town, to get out of the winter and go down south to France, to go in the more sunlight, to see the more beautiful landscapes of France, that will lead to less desperation and more inspiration, if you will. And that allowed Van Gogh to put out some of his finest work to date by listening to Gauguin in his later years. And that was just a very powerfully moving scene. Another scene that I liked quite well too, Ryan, I'm going to touch on, was the scene with Mads Mikkelsen playing the father.
Yes.
Wow, that was a moving moment. Mads Mikkelsen is a priest in the movie, and Van Gogh is opening up to him in many levels, and the priest is pressing him, like, why are you doing this? Why are you why are you continuing to paint these paintings? Why are you continuing with your art when you're not successful? Your paintings, look at them, they're ugly. He tells them flat out. It's like, oh my God, here's a priest, a high-minded individual, highly respectable individual, pretty much begrudging you, belittling you, the talent that you have, and just the resilience and the emotions that Defoe delivers in that particular scene, because he says right in the film, because it's the only thing I'm good at. I've tried other things, he tells him.
Mm-hmm.
Right there was just a very moving moment. That's where I was completely sold on the movie, and just a lot of great moments. So for me, Willem Dafoe, hands down, delivers the finest performance of the year. I hope he gets an Oscar nomination. He did pull off a Golden Globe nomination, but it's very stacked, and like you said, the movie didn't do as well on a box office level, and he's just up against very fierce competition. But for me, Dafoe, out of all his performance, gives a very personal performance that I feel like a lot of other performances were missing.
He's one of our greatest living actors, almost indisputably.
And how about Julian Chernobyl, just as a director? He's just a very visual director, which would make sense. He is an artist and whatnot, but he's got a very distinctive visual style. And looking at that film, the aesthetics reminded me a lot of Terrence Malick and Ingmar Bergman.
Yes.
There's a lot of great visual moments in the film, just very strong observational moments. How the film captured his isolation was quite well. Just that beautiful moment of Van Gogh on the wagon with the horse and him riding the back of the horse. There's just so many great moments like that. The camera just floating around with, you know, dead, decayed sunflowers was quite striking as well. Just overall, just a great visually masterfully made movie.
Well, I would be amiss were I not to bring up The Other Side of the Wind, the new film by Orson Welles, famed director of Citizen Kane, widely considered to be one of the greatest films ever made, Touch of Evil, Lady from Shanghai, Magnificent Ambersons, Chimes at Midnight. I mean, Orson Welles, among people who truly love cinema, it's almost unanimously agreed upon that he's one of the greatest directors of all time. And this film, The Other Side of the Wind, by the way, the best thing that Netflix did this year, that and the accompanying documentary, is the strangest thing that he's ever done. It's at once uniquely Orson Welles, and at the same time, you can't believe that it's him that did it. It's so bizarre, so off the wall, but it works beautifully, in my opinion. I mean, where does one even begin to describe this film? It's so meta. There are several layers of it. It's about a film called The Other Side of the Wind. The protagonist of the film is a director played by an actual director, John Huston, who is also one of the greatest of all time. I mean, he directed The Treasure of the Sierra Madre, The Maltese Falcon, The African Queen. These are absolute touchstones of American cinema. You know, so this teaming up of the two of them was unprecedented. And it's such a strange film. It was shot in the 70s over a six-year period, and then the editing went in well into the 80s, and it just never got done. The director, Peter Bogdanovich, Orson Welles was sort of his mentor, and he's heavily involved in the film, both during the shooting back in the 70s and the current restoration, and finally the release of it just a couple months ago. And in my opinion, it was worth the wait. It is extremely academic, extremely experimental. It is, as I said, deeply meta and way ahead of its time. You see so many of the techniques used in The Other Side of the Wind appear in films that came years later. And it's very difficult to describe, very difficult to talk about. But if you're someone who truly loves the medium, I cannot recommend it highly enough. Would you like to comment on The Other Side of the Wind, Rob?
Yeah, you know, I watched it on Netflix, and it was artfully made for one. And looking at this movie, it is very messy. Of course you're looking at it and be like, it's a mess. I mean, my gosh, they have, what, 70, 80 hours of footage to edit it together? But I commend Bogdanovich and others for finally getting this movie made, because when you watch it, it's undeniably fascinating. It's fascinating on an aesthetic level. It is fascinating on a thematic level. And you know, that film within a film, is for me, works quite well. You know, at first it comes off like a parody. Like, oh gosh, it's just Orson Welles ripping on Michelangelo Antonioni's Italian art house movies at that time. And even the actor in that movie resembles the lead actor in Blow Up.
Yeah.
You know, but that film within a film there, where it cuts back and forth from John Huston at the party getting ready to screen the movie, and just chaos erupts with everybody else in the industry there, with reporters and such, and other things unravel, but it cuts back and forth between that movie, and then you start getting hooked towards that movie within a movie. You're like, wow, and it actually ends up becoming very hallucinatory at moments. Mm-hmm. It becomes very surreal, and Welles, while parodying that style, ends up making it very effective. The last 10-15 minutes of that movie, your jaw's dropping in just how magnificent the visuals were in that particular moment. I felt like I was watching a Alejandro Jodorowsky movie in those last 10 minutes. And there, you have to look at that movie. Like you said, there's techniques in that movie that are way ahead of its time. It just goes to show how great of an artist Orson Welles was. I mean, there's stuff in there where you're seeing like the Dogma 95 style in that film, the very loose cuts, the pseudo-documentary feel is there, the grittiness is there, and then you cut into the experimental stuff and you see the film within a film, which was kind of new at the time. I mean, we had like Fellini's 8.5 at the time, and of course Truffaut's Day for Night, but that many filmmakers were really experimenting that. So Welles experimented with that, and I think he pulls it off quite well in the movie. I think anybody who truly cares about cinema, who's fascinated by cinema, will appreciate this movie.
It's also another one, like I said, with Let the Sun Shine In. This is clearly a very personal film. The premise of it, it's revealed at the very beginning in a voiceover narration that the director, played by John Huston, is throwing a party to screen a cut of his most recent film, which is titled The Other Side of the Wind. And he's kind of broken down mess, and it's revealed that it's going to be the last night of his life. He's going to die leaving the party. And I think Welles very much saw himself that way at that point in his life. And anybody who knows his story, he was a genius and also a tragic figure. You know, at that point, I mean, Other Side of the Wind really is like a DIY independent film before its time, because he burned every bridge that he'd ever crossed at that point. You know, Hollywood wanted nothing to do with him, and for being as brilliant as he was and making Citizen Kane, which everyone still talks about to this day, it's just, you know, it's almost kind of discouraging to think about how much trouble he had getting financing and stuff like that.
You know, for sure. And then now we look at that film had a crowdfunding online. It had some crowdfunding, and you saw names like Spike Jones and Sofia Coppola and Wes Anderson, I believe, at the end credits contributing to that. So it's great that there's wonderful filmmakers out there supporting this, and that we finally have this movie. Because we always heard the unfinished Orson Welles movie. We never would think we'd be here today talking about that. We always heard about, from your film professor, that, hey, you know, Orson Welles did a movie called The Other Side of the Wind that never got made. We always heard about that unfinished Orson Welles movie, and here we are today with the resources that we have, with the forms of media that we could get the film out there and celebrate it. Now, is it something that Orson Welles would approve of? I guess we'll never know. It's his grave not been turned over, right? But, you know, that being said, it's certainly a fascinating and experimental work of art, and definitely inspirational on many levels. You see, there has to be, like, rough cuts of that movie that's been screened to other people. Mm-hmm. You see cuts in that movie that Oliver Stone used, like in JFK and Nixon. Like, wow, that's the way it's framed. And the movie looks like it's right out of an Oliver Stone movie. Like, Oliver Stone played with some of that stock footage aesthetics that were found in that movie.
Yes. The rapid transitions from black and white to color, and the emotional reactions with close-up shots that are very quickly edited and what have you. I'd like to mention, while we're on the subject of the film, it was edited together by Bob Murawski of the distribution company Grindhouse Releasing. It was founded by... The company was founded by Bob Murawski and Sage Stallone, Sylvester Stallone's son, who's sadly no longer with us. But they've released a lot of, grindhouse films, you know, that kind of gritty horror stuff from the 70s and whatnot. But I think the editing job, especially considering the bulk of material that he had to work through, is tremendous. And I think it deserves an Academy Award nomination for editing, but I'm not holding my breath on that one. Nevertheless, he does deserve acknowledgement.
Yeah, it's definitely certainly a essential movie, and anybody who wants to dive into the brilliant filmography of Orson Welles needs to put this on the top of their list. All right, well, the next film I'd like to bring up is the film that made a strong impact on me this year, is Lynn Ramsey's You Were Never Really Here. Now, this film is a very stylized, it's a neo-noir film starring Joaquin Phoenix as the lone wolf hitman or bounty hunter, however we're going to look at him, and he's very much tormented, and the film captures his psyche quite well. The film really gets inside the mind of a contract killer quite well, and this guy, this man in the character Joe that he plays, for one, it's a great performance by Joaquin Phoenix. I would say it's one of his finest performances he's ever done. It's right up there with his performance in The Master by P.T. Anderson, and as well as Gus Van Sant's To Die For, and just overall a very brilliant performance. And as we know, Joaquin Phoenix works so well with so many great directors. And this film, he plays a hitman who's hired by D.C. outsiders to find the daughter of a state senator. And come to find out, the daughter is kidnapped and abducted, and she's involved in a sex ring. And there's a lot of stuff in the film that is very disturbing. And one could watch it and say it's a very violent movie, but it's actually, what's fascinating about the movie, Ryan, is if you look at it, you don't see the violence in the movie. The violence is always cut away in the film. And it's always happening off screen, almost like a Hitchcock movie. And in our mind, that's the reason why it's so effective, is in our mind it plays off that violence quite well, because really what Ramsey's trying to say is that the violence is worse because we have to live with the trauma. And in this film, his character is definitely the one with the trauma. This is a character that has constant flashbacks of the violence that he endured as a child. He's also a Iraq war veteran, it's suggested at that point. And he's also suicidal. There's moments in the movie where he's breathing in a bag. He dreams of shooting himself and stuff like that. It's a very disturbing film, but there's also very much a lot of redemption in the character, and he finds that redemption with this young girl as he saves her. It's been compared to a Taxi Driver, because there's a lot of parallels, because Jodie Foster's character was coerced into sex trafficking at a young age in that film, and this young girl, who's even younger, which makes it even more disturbing, in the film, he has to go and rescue her, and there's a scene where he rescues her the first time, because she gets abducted. and all the violence takes place in a surveillance camera. And I know some people didn't really like that. I like it. I like the whole pattern of the movie, the violence taking place off screen, and it's definitely fragmented. It's cut together, and we hear like an old 50s song playing over the violence and the maddening stuff going on. And it's a very effective scene, and it really plays in your mind quite well. And then when you leave the theater, you think it's more violent than what it actually is. Because I went and revisited this film, I was like, wow, there actually is a lot of violence in this movie, but it's all off screen. I didn't really think about it until I saw it the second time, because you walk out the theater, you kind of you're traumatized yourself as the viewer from that. And I think Ramsey's kind of playing off that quite well. It's really a brilliant piece of filmmaking. It's psychologically brilliant to the viewer, and there's something very academic going on in her storytelling. I think she's a very bold and uncompromising filmmaker. She's done so much stuff in the past. She's directed such films as Morven Collar, starring Samantha Morton. Her first feature was Ratcatcher, and we need to talk about Kevin, which also dealt with school shootings. And she was supposed to direct the film Jane Got a Gun, starring Jane Fonda. I'm sorry. She was also supposed to do a movie called Jane Got a Gun, starring Natalie Portman, which went on to be directed by someone else, but she was let go of that movie because she wasn't comfortable dealing with the violence in the film. She was very uncomfortable doing violence in the movie, where she ended up coming up with another approach to it, and I think it worked quite well for somebody who's never really staged those kind of sequences well, making an impact at the movie at the same time. You know, I'm just very fascinated to see what Lynn Ramsey does next. And you know, there's a lot of people out there saying, well, we need more women in cinema. Here's another great female director right now that made a brilliantly directed, visually arresting movie that delivers such impeccable craftsmanship in the film that, quite frankly, is comparable with the greats of Brian De Palma and Martin Scorsese. It has this meticulous visual direction to it, and the staging and the framing is just so brilliant in the film, and it's glossy, but at the same time it feels raw. And you know, when I watched it the second time, this is a movie you do have to revisit. The second viewing of this film, I didn't notice how engaging the film is, because Joaquin Phoenix is certainly brilliant in the movie, and there's a great moment in the film where he's there for his mom, played by Judith Roberts. His mom in the film is played by the Eraserhead actress, who is the beautiful woman across the Hall, who is now a lot older, of course, being almost 40 years older since that movie's been out. But he's there for his mom, and he's goes through a refrigerator, and it's a very tender moment. He's like, Mom, throw this stuff out. It's how old is it? And it brings a lot of life to that character. And then in the film, there's a really great arc in the movie, especially with that young girl. There's a moment in the film where she gets abducted again by DC officials, by the police or whatever, because whatever they're doing, they're trying to cover something up. It's not exactly told, but you as the viewer is allowed to kind of piece the mystery together. And we never exactly know the corruption going on. There's definitely a sex ring going on with children in the Washington, D.C. area. You know, that being said, in the film, he tries to go out looking for her again, and he almost gives up on the case. And not to reveal anything, but a tragedy happens involving his mom. So he goes to the lake and he just almost drowns himself. Then he sees a vision of the young girl. And as soon as he sees that vision, it's a very hallucinatory moment of him sinking underwater. And we see this image of this young girl that he rescued the first time. Then she disappears again. And that gives him a boost of life. He comes up and he's gasping for air. And it's almost like that's his transcendence of life. And there he reborns into like a stronger person, because I think Lynn Ramsey is also playing with the male archetype, noir-type character in this movie, especially with a lot of the Me Too movements going on and stuff we're hearing on college campuses. People are saying masculinity is toxic, but Lynn Ramsey, being the female director she is, she's pretty much showing that you can't suppress this. You can't suppress it in human nature, nor can you suppress it in the filmic tense. So we're seeing that quite well in movies, and you're seeing her play with this archetype, and she completely transcends that archetype. Now, real quick, Ryan, you're a fan of noir. I know you weren't really a big fan of the movie, but would you revisit it, do you think? What do you think about the points of t- t- touching on here.
I would be willing to revisit You Were Never Really Here. I was not crazy about it when I first saw it. I think it's very well directed, very polished, but ultimately very spare. But I will say there are women doing great work in film and literature, many of them, and this is rarely acknowledged. You know, I think this idea that women are boxed out of these mediums is false outrage for the most part. You know, I support work being judged on its merit, regardless of the gender of the artist. But I mean, there are many examples in film and literature, especially, of women that are doing great work, recent work, you know, some of the best of the year, and this is rarely talked about because it kind of defeats the outrage narrative that's so popular nowadays.
Oh, we're hearing it all the time. It's like last year, you know, they were saying lack of female directors, and then eventually with that buzz, especially with the Me Too movement going on, you know, Greta Gerwig was nominated for Lady Bird, and I enjoyed Lady Bird. It was an enjoyable movie, but let's face it, it's not this brilliantly directed, technically impressive, visually arresting movie like something like You Were Never Really Here is, or like the work of Claire Denis. And even Sofia Coppola, who won Best Director at the Cannes Film Festival, was completely snubbed last year for the brilliant film The Beguiled. So, and I hear from a lot of other people too, women don't get fair shakes in Hollywood and stuff like that. Well, they don't even go see these movies. I'm like, well, sit down and watch You Were Never Really Here. Watch Let the Sun Shine In. Watch The Beguiled. Yeah. I don't love these movies because they're directed by women. They just happen to be great films directed by brilliant directors who happen to be female. But at the same time, for people to try to make a statement while not seeing these movies just makes me feel like they don't know what they're talking about. They're missing out, really, because between this film and Let the Sunshine In, there are certainly great female directors out there pumping out works. It's not my fault you guys aren't looking into them.
Exactly. One of the biggest surprises of the year was undeniably the film Burning, directed by Lee Chang-do. And I personally was not and am still not familiar with any of his previous work, but this is a Korean film that sort of had a lot of word of mouth buzz, and that's how I became aware of it. And Robert and I were both searching for screenings here in Michigan after having heard it praised so highly, and we eventually ended up in Ann Arbor watching it on opening day about 3 weeks ago, I would say, and the film was astounding. I mean, I didn't know what to expect. I don't necessarily love every foreign film that I see. I think many of them can be alienating sometimes, and I do like a lot of Asian cinema. I don't like all of it, but this, I did not know what to expect. And it is a Hitchcockian thriller, though very modern, and done spectacularly well. I don't know how much of the plot points we want to get in here. It's about an isolated young writer that reunites with a girl from his childhood and falls in love with her, but they're blossoming romance is soon interrupted by a wealthy young playboy type that just sort of appears out of nowhere. And this is where the film really catches fire. The girl goes missing shortly after, and we find ourselves headlong in a deeply compelling mystery. Rob, what would you like to say about Burning?
Well, I didn't know too much about the movie when I first saw it, and I'm happy about that. I didn't watch a trailer. I didn't read up what it was about. All I knew was that it was by Lee Chang-dong, who did a film that I absolutely loved. It was released in 2011, titled Poetry. And he did a film about 10 years ago, titled Sunshine Clean, that I saw, which I really enjoyed. So, not knowing too much about the movie, other than the fact it won a big award at the Cannes Film Festival, went into it blindly, and I just walked out very blown away by it. Talk about endings. Like earlier I mentioned, the finale for The House That Jack Built was one of the strongest endings of the year. I would say that this ending was absolutely unnerving and also, in a way, oddly empowering. Because in the film, you see the main character, Lily Jansoon, I think his name is, played by actor Ahn Yu. And in the film, you see him, the film opens up an opening shot, and it's a tracking shot. He's walking, and he runs into the young woman who is a former classmate, and you see him, and he's very stoic. He's very confident. he is almost like the archetype of your masculine man character. In the movie, he's very strong. He continues that strength when he's with her, and then it finds out that she is going to some random trip to Africa in the movie, and then she asks him to watch the cat, which is really clever in the movie, because we don't really see the cat in the apartment. So he starts to look over the cat, and clearly there is a cat, there's kitty litter there, and he cleans it up and whatnot, and she goes on this escapade, this random trip to Africa. And what I liked most about this opening stuff here, Ryan, is the fact that it just really builds up the worlds. We open up in South Korea. This is a very modern variation of the two Koreas. As we know, North Korea is trapped in this very old world, and we have South Korea, which is a very prosperous world, a very modern world. So we're very much introduced right to this in the very opening scenes of the movie. And he is an aspiring writer. He takes care of his father's farms, and his father is on jail for some type of assault by the officials, and he goes in and out of the courtroom when we see his father there, and he's looking after the farm, and the farm's pretty near North Korea. So it's really building up the Asian themes that we've seen in other films in the past, like Uncle Boomy, who could recall his past lives, and now this. It just really builds up the Asian themes that they like to cover of the old world versus the new world. And you know, the character that she brings back named Ben, played by Steven Yeun, who I feel gives the best supporting performance of the year in a supporting actor category. The Steven Yeun, as we all know from The Walking Dead, who also appeared in this year's Sorry to Bother You, is just absolutely terrific here. He's just a very sinister villain. He gets under your skin, and at times he's very calculated, and it's very much a cat and mouse game between Ben and Lee Jin-sun here. And it's just overall an impeccably made movie. Like you said, there's a lot of Hitchcockian moments. It's brilliantly crafted. It takes you in directions you don't know. And to me, that's what Ben represents. Ben represents more of the modern world, colliding with Lee Jin-sun, who is very much like the old world. And both of these characters are facing off and colliding with each other.
Indeed, I agree that the performance by Steven Yeun as the character Ben is unbelievably strong. Definitely one of the best of the year. I was saying as we were walking out of the film, that's like the Asian Patrick Bateman. But it's even more subtle and nuanced in this film. But the guy clearly is giving off some sociopath vibes. But if you've seen that actor in anything else, it's quite remarkable how well he is able to embody a character, because this is a very unique performance, even when held up against others of his. And yes, I think it's also worth mentioning the film Burning is based on a short story by Haruki Murakami. The story by Murakami is based on the Faulkner classic short story called Barn Burning. And all of that ties into the film. And I'm not going to spoil any of those details, but this is one I recommend you see. Even if you're listening to this and you're not usually an avid film goer or anything, this is a good starter foreign film, because even though it is intelligent, elegant, and well done in every way, it's not alienating. You know, I think the story is interesting and compelling enough to appeal to mainstream audiences.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think this film's going to get a bigger following in years to come. This is a movie that mainstream audiences, I think, could watch and they wouldn't even pay attention to the subtitles, because it's that engrossing. And I really think this movie would probably get a U.S. remake one day, God forbid, but you know, it happens sometimes, yeah. You know. But yeah, just like, it's just amazing just how engrossing this film is. It just takes you in directions you don't anticipate. You don't know where it's heading. You wait for it to unfold. It really gets under your skin in many ways. The Ben character, like I said, he's just so calculated and cruel. And all we really have as the viewer is a lot of ambiguity and a lot of circumstantial evidence where you think he might be behind the young woman's death, and or disappearance, rather. And the way the main protagonist pieces the film together is just so brilliantly done, and the way it's paced, the way it unfolds and unravels is just absolutely astonishing. But Burning was definitely a great pick there, Ryan. Now, the next film I want to talk about carries over to Asian culture as well, and that's Isle of Dogs, written and directed by iconic director Wes Anderson. Now, this film bizarre enough, got some controversy earlier in the year simply because they said it was cultural appropriations. I think it's just completely nonsensical. This movie really much plays tribute to Japanese culture quite well. You know, in the film, it's not mocking it. It's not condescending it at all. And I think the whole conscious decision of having the Japanese humans pretty much speak in subtitles was quite clever. And I think that having the dogs speak English kind of just showed the translation differences, because in the end of the day, humans and dogs can't really speak to each other. So I thought that worked quite well. And overall, it's just a very clever movie. It's very whimsical. I would say that it's Wes Anderson's funniest movie, believe it or not, to date. It's not just deadpan humor. It's like generally laugh out loud funny. I saw this movie in a very crowded theater, and the whole audience just loved it. It was just uproariously funny, and it's also very tender. Wes Anderson, who loves to bring the characterizations and the human pathos, worked quite well in here with animals, and just, especially if you're a dog person, if you love dogs, you're going to really click with this movie. I'm a dog person, I love dogs, and it's funny, the title, I Love Dogs and I Love Dogs, isn't that something? But
phonetically similar.
No, for sure, and, you know, overall, just a really great tribute overall to Japanese culture, and just some great influences as well. You see some derivative influences, rightfully so, to great Japanese filmmakers like Akira Kurosawa, and, you know, just everything from the framing in that film just looks like it's right out of a Kurosawa movie, but done in animation. And the dogs in the film, the characters of the dogs, with a great cast, may I add, especially the lead dog named Chief, voiced so well by Bryan Cranston, we know is from Breaking Bad. It's just great as the dog, and we have other voices in the film done by, you know, Bill Murray, of course, and Jeff Goldblum, Bob Balaban, and Scarlett Johansson. They all come to life quite well, and just a very fun movie. I would say out of all of Wes Anderson's films, I would say this is the most fun one. It's very much like a companion piece to his fantastic Mr. Fox. The animation's absolutely stellar here. It's personally my favorite animated film of the year, and I do feel like it's losing traction and steam because of its controversies and uproar that's just so silly and nonsensical and unwarranted. And, you know, I would certainly put this up there with The Royal Tenenbaums and The Grand Budapest Hotel as being one of Wes Anderson's finest films indeed.
I loved it. I don't have an incredible amount to add to what you said, but I thought it was a very charming movie. One of the best claymation films ever done. I mean, the claymation animation is so far advanced beyond anything really that we've known prior to it, but it is just a solid movie. And I'm someone, I've never liked a film by Wes Anderson until Isle of Dogs, but once again, it is essential viewing for anyone that has loved a pet.
Oh, for sure. And it's got a really clever premise, too. Just the whole notion of these dogs needing to be quarantined and they're put off to an island, I think really explores the nature of fear and how fear really much can ruin a culture and rise to totalitarianism. And we see uprisings and stuff like that. So really played that on that in a very playful way. And I liked how it wasn't preachy or heavy-handed at all. It just brought it, all those ideas, in a very subtle way while not trying to make any modern statement. It just was a high-minded children's film that adults could also enjoy at the same time. And I saw kids really enjoy this film. Their parents were laughing out loud. And I recommend this movie to a lot of people, and they seem to really enjoy it. And especially my brother, who's not really into movies like me, he's really a much a dog person too. He absolutely was thrilled with this film. And this is a movie that, out of all the movies released this year, this is the one I probably had the most fun with. I just had a smile on my face the whole time. And it just brings a lot of joy and delight throughout.
Well, now for a change of pace, I'm going to talk about a film that tonally is the polar opposite of Isle of Dogs, and it's one that I followed the production of for several years, honestly, with much derision initially. I'm talking about Luca Guadagnino's remake of Suspiria, a film from the late 70s directed by Dario Argento, an Italian master of horror and someone I have been a fan of for many years now. I love the original Suspiria film. I think it's totally fantastic, and I balked at the idea of someone remaking it. I thought the poster looked bad initially. I thought the trailer was very drab, but I agreed to go see it because I am a soldier of cinema. I was pleasantly surprised. It is one of the most complex, layered, unnerving, and brutal films of the year. It's totally one of a kind. Like Guadagnino has said, he doesn't see it as a remake so much as a cover version of the original Suspiria. And I should say, you know, some background, Argento, the man who directed the original Suspiria, he's known for what's known as the giallo type of horror, which is, it's one of those things where you know it if you see it. It's very idiosyncratic, very unique to Italy and whatnot. A lot of like, almost like surrealism and heightened colors and things like that. It's, if you're into it, it's very cool stuff. But Guadagnino takes a very different approach in that it's, his film is very gray. I would say the new Suspiria is very gray and red. You know, it's almost like a brutalist architecture or something, but it deals with a coven of witches who are using a dance school as a front, which is the plot of the original film, but in the remake it's only the skeleton of the plot. And this explores all kinds of political and historical subtext, and it really is a dense and layered film. And this one, I will admit, is not for everybody, but I found it to be very rewarding and totally caught me off guard and how strong it really is.
You know, I absolutely love this film as well. I think it's a masterpiece, and Guadagnino has just proven himself to be one of the finer filmmakers to emerge out of this decade. You know, between making a film like I Am Love, which was released here in 2010, A Bigger Splash, last year's Call Me By Your Name, and all this, he's just proven himself to be quite a craftsman. Now, this film, Suspiria, is a very polarizing movie. It, you know, is very divided by film critics, but I will tell you what, I was on the side of loving this film, and just not just for its themes and its rich ideas, just really for its technique, and I really commend Guadagnino for taking this film in a completely different direction than what it originally entailed, because of the fact, if this was in lesser hands, it just would have been like another hackneyed, dumbed-down version of a classic remake, but now that this film is in better hands of a great artist like Guadagnino, he was able to make a film, like you said, it's like a cover rather than a remake. And he was able to reinterpret it and put his own vision into it that made it feel the polar opposite. In fact, you could name this film something different, and I wouldn't think it was a remake of Suspiria at all. It would just, I would say there were similarities with like the dance school, but it feels like a completely different film. And my goodness, just so much great sequences in this film. So much set pieces, which is just jaw-dropping. It's a very elaborate movie, and every chapter in the film, this is the year of chapters, I will say, each chapter that was in this film, I was just completely engrossed from beginning to end, and especially the dance sequences and the numbers. How great was that scene when they put the spell on that one dancer, and they want to pretty much get rid of her in the company. Yeah. They cast that spell on her because they feel that Dakota Johnson's character is really the one to pull this off, because they could sense it, and they just completely kill off the other girl who's supposed to play the lead of that, and just they slam her into walls, or muscles and arms are breaking. It's just a cringe-worthy scene, and almost one of the most terrifying scenes of the moment, all thanks to just brilliant direction by Guadagnino, and man, just everything from the framing to the mood to the atmosphere in that film just really built up a heightened suspense that you don't get to see too often in a lot of modern horror films.
And it's great that he didn't attempt a straight remake of Suspiria, because that would have absolutely landed on its face. Anyone here who's a fan of horror or surrealism, I highly recommend the original Suspiria if you haven't seen it, but it is absolutely the type of film that could never exist outside of 1970s Italy. You know, it's so idiosyncratic. I mean, one of the most unique movies of the 70s. There's really nothing like it. It's like at once art house and camp, at once horror and almost like avant-garde.
Yeah, and I would say that this new Suspiria is very avant-garde in many ways.
Yes.
It carries on those traditions, and everything from like the nightmarish flashbacks that we see from our main protagonist that is completely influenced by Maya Darren's work is absolutely chilling and artistically rich. And Dakota Johnson and Tilda Swinton are absolutely brilliant. They have great synergy on screen together. And Tilda Swinton plays three roles in this film. What a commanding performance there.
I didn't realize until afterwards that it's her playing the psychoanalyst.
Yes, that was, I started picking up on it because I did hear she played multiple roles at first. I didn't know that, but I'm like, oh, it's Tilda Swinton. But it's impressive makeup that's under her in that particular performance. And that character is quite rich. There's a lot of layers in this movie. It's part horror film, but it's got a lot of political subtext. Like you said, it's a very dense movie. It's very multi-layered. It's very cerebral. There's a lot to talk about. The setting's really important. Here we are in East Berlin in the 70s. And if you go back in history, look at the Bader-Meinhof complex. These were young terrorists who were very ideological driven, who really wanted to distance themselves from the German history that they felt like they were neglecting. They felt like that the German history at the time just could wash over and whitewash a lot of history. And they felt like this rise of the Soviet Union, this Cultural Revolution that was taking place in the aftermath of the setting of this was the way that they could represent and apologize for the past sins. And there's just a lot of rich ideas there. And then they also, Guadagnino shows kind of the consequences of that ideology, how it leads to terrorism. And we see Berlin very divided and almost Berlin falling by these new ideologies from the new Soviet Union colliding with the old fascist ways and how Berlin's kind of falling apart during this.
There's a lot going on. And as I said, it's not for everybody, but if you are within the demographic that this kind of thing appeals to, it's one of the, I would say the Suspiria remake not sucking is perhaps the biggest surprise of 2018.
Right.
Though, I mean, like you said, it is a talented filmmaker at the helm, but I actually didn't realize that until later in the game.
And then how about Tom York's score in that film? And just how it elevated the dance numbers. And how much thought was put in this movie, and how much choreography is just absolutely astonishing.
Indeed.
And I wanted to add to the cinematography in this film by cinematographer Sayabu Mucky Dupram, who did the cinematography for Uncle Boomy, who calls Past Lives, and he also did the cinematography for Guadagnino's previous film, Call Me By Your Name. The cinematography here is just absolutely lush, terrifying at the same time, and just artfully done. It's some of the finest cinematography of the year. One of the most beautifully framed and beautifully shot movies of the year, and it's not getting enough credit. I would say out of all the films that we watched this year, I would probably say that offers the finest cinematography this year.
The soldiers of cinema approve of Suspiria.
And we pretty much saved the best for last here. At least on my end, this was my favorite film of the year. And this is perhaps the most critically acclaimed movie of the year. And I agree with the acclaim. Sometimes there's movies that come out and I feel like the film critics just overpraise. But this next film here is Roma, written and directed and shot, rather, by Alfonso Cuarón, the brilliant master of such masterpieces as Children of Men, Y Tu Mama Tambien, and Gravity, and now Roma. Here is absolutely arresting. Now, I don't even know where to begin with this film other than when I walked out of the movie, it worked on all levels. Every single level you could think of, it was impressive on a visual level. It was impressive on a thematic level. It emotionally moved me. I was crushed walking out of this theater. I was deeply moved. This was actually the first movie that I cried in since last year's Sean Baker's The Florida Project, since that film. And I walked out of that film devastated, but I was never manipulated. You know, there's a difference when a movie crushes you and it manipulates you. This film is not. And this film is just so obvious to say that it's artfully made and beautifully shot in a fully realized work of art. What the film has going for it, though, is many layers. It's epic in scope. And it's also very personal. Looking at this film, I had no idea what it was about. I avoided all the trailers. I knew that it had high buzz at the Toronto Film Festival as well as the Venice Film Festival. I believe it won the top prize at both those film festivals. And I just absolutely love Cuarón. I've been following his career pretty much ever since I was a teenager. I loved A Little Princess and I really liked Great Expectations at the time. Then I was blown away by Y Tu Mama Tambien and, of course, Children of Men was where he completely impressed me that he was a great visual artist. And now this film is deeply personal, and I was watching this movie, I was like, nobody can make this movie unless they experience some of this stuff. And as you watch it, you see a young woman in the film named Cleo, played wonderfully by upcoming actress Yelena Aparicio. I hope I'm pronouncing her name right. But at any rate, she plays a maid in the film and also a house sitter that watches the kids, cleans the houses, does the chores for a wealthier family. And the children in the film is certainly has to be one of Karan's, a reflection of Karan, rather, an alter ego, if you will. But this film just really, it's really observational at first. It starts off 20 minutes just playing and observing and just observing their daily way of life. But then the film starts to unfold once it's discovered that Cleo is pregnant to a man that does not love her in return. And she's trying to sort it all out. And from there, the film becomes overall just a rich and powerful study of humanity. It's a deeply humane movie, one of the most personal films of the year. And you go on this journey of Cleo where she goes, really, it's really an episodic movie if you think about it. And they go from location to location and she has to deal with all these trials and tribulations of her pregnancy. And not to reveal anything, but there's just some great sequences and set pieces in this movie. Everything from her being trapped in this revolution going on in Mexico to a moment where they go on vacation and there's wildfires going on to, you know, you name it. There's another beautiful scene, Ryan, where she's watching the movie with the boyfriend and she, right in the credits roll, everybody's walking out of the theater and she tells him that she's pregnant. He doesn't know how to sink it in. He goes, well, I have to go to the bathroom. He leaves her there. It's just a very crushing moment. And I'm not going to even talk about the final scene, but it leaves you just devastated. But it's overall just a true work of art and a towering masterpiece of cinema.
Absolutely. And I liked it more than I expected to. And I knew that it was going to be very good, but it's actually, the narrative is more engaging. It's more emotionally resonant than I was expecting from an art house film of that nature. I have been a fan of Karan for some time, but this was the movie that really pushed me over the edge and honoring him as a modern day auteur. I mean, it really is a marvel, and some of the photography is stunning, and I recommend it. I think it's the best thing that Netflix distributed this year. That's by far, well, that or the new Wells film, but those were two standout releases, and I'll give credit where credit's due.
Yeah, and again, it's just a deeply humane work here, and there's just a moment, too, where she goes to the hospital, and it's not preachy or didactic at all, but the doctor asks the woman that takes her there, is she insured? And it cuts away after that, but it just goes to show that we're all human after all, and You really love this woman, Cleo. You're really drawn into her. For me, Karan almost photographs her and stages her almost like it's a Fleeny character in a way, like early Fleeny. I'm talking about like 50s Lestrada Fleeny when he was working with his wife at the time.
Yeah, Julia Messina.
Yeah, exactly. Like she has this look about her, this vulnerability, and you're just really drawn into her presence. And just looking at that, it's one of my favorite characters I've seen in a movie in quite some time. Just seeing her, you get good vibes. She's a woman of grace. And just by her presence, it makes the film a film of grace.
And it's worth mentioning, I read after the experience of having seen it in the theater it was 2 weeks ago, I believe, that we went to Ann Arbor and saw that. But the young actress who plays Cleo?
Yes.
Cleo is her name. She had no idea who Alfonso Cuarón was when she tried out for the role. So I guess those are honest intentions anyway.
And what's interesting too, Ryan, is I read the other day that the actress, or the character that she plays, the character Cleo has appeared in Cuarón's other movies that like made a cameo in like Y Tu Mamá También.
Okay.
So this is definitely a person that was really close to Alfonso Cuarón. So that goes to show, like, I had no idea what this movie was about. Walking out, I just knew that there was something personal about it. You could see him just playing wonderful tribute to, like, the women in our lives, to the mothers that raise us, or to the nannies that raise us, that they leave an imprint in our lives, whether we want to admit it or not. This is a part of nature that we need to embrace.
Well, I raise my glass to those of you who are still with us. This has been a marathon session, but we felt it necessary. It has been an exceptionally good year for cinema, and we were happy to take part in it. We want to get this out before the end of the year. I hope that our passion comes through, and I hope that my next podcast arrives sooner than 7 months from now, and I have a feeling that it will. I think 2019 is going to be one of my best years ever. I'm feeling optimistic about it. God bless all of you, and thank you.
I want to say thank you for having me here, Ryan. I hope to do more of these types of podcasts. I hope we get a stronger viewership, listenership, if you will. And thank you guys for listening. Check all these films out. You could stream them. Check them out at the theater if they're still playing. These are essential masterpieces that I believe we'll be talking about in years to come.